So next, I think we have a film, a short clip from our previous county president, Jan Lievius, the one who recruited Fred to come back. And he is on his way to Amsterdam today, so he couldn't be here. But he picked the message for us, so we're going to play that.
Ladies and gentlemen, families and friends of Fred Law, first of all, I would like to apologize. I'm in the airplane. I'm 3 hours away from Amsterdam and will not be able to participate personally with you for this occasion. Fred was really an excellent leader. He's an excellent scientist and a scholar. I was so happy when Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics was started to build the SMA. He did play a very important role in carry out the collaboration between Harvard Smithsonian and ourselves, and also for the design and planning of the new building. I was so fortunate when I was the president of the Academia Sinica, we have been able to convince Fred to come back to work with us. At that time, I was so convinced that the Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics, with a good vision, good program, with a good leader, and pursued excellent science in the highest level, we have a great future. So far, so we have money to build the telescope or the equipment. And I did help a little bit on that direction. When Fred came back to Taiwan, I did observe many young scientists in Taiwan were not very healthy. They didn't have enough exercise, and many of them lived were too early. So I suggested to Academia Sinica, or everybody who passed 45 years old should take a compulsory medical examination. Fred was among the first group, and he did find his lung cancer. And he goes through the chemical therapy and radiation therapy and recovered very well. And every time when he saw me, he was always joking and said, "Yuan, you saved my life. If I did not decide to come back to Taiwan, work as a director for the Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics, he might not have survived for several more years." So I was very proud that I did save his life when he left us. After such a great accomplishment, he decided to take the directorship in the Radio Astronomy Observatory in the United States. I was kind of disappointed that he was leaving us, but Frank Xu Xiaosheng came to comfort me and said, "Yuan, why don't we look at these things from the other angle?" He said, "Because we have done well. Fred did take a good leadership, so U.S. asked him to become the director of Radio Astronomy Observatory in the United States. So that shows that we have done well. Fred did accomplish something that is a very, very positive thing for the global astronomy and astrophysics. And he did play an important role in ARMA and got us involved in the development of ARMA." And for Academia Sinica, I knew all along the Academia Sinica were to do well. We do need to have a good leader. We do have to have a good scientific program, good vision, and also we need the fund. I did help a little bit to raise the fund to accomplish what they have decided to do. And I'm really sorry Fred is no longer with us, but I think he will remain in our heart forever. And I want to thank all of you who worked together with Fred, and especially families of Fred. You certainly have sacrificed a lot for giving Fred to work with us in Taiwan. Well, thank you very much.
So Yuanli always says he did a little bit. He actually did a lot. But he's always very modest in saying that he helped us a little bit. He helped us an awful lot. He's one of the reasons why the Institute has grown very well. And Fred always said that. But after coming back to Taiwan, there's many people who actually helped Fred along the way. I'm going to ask Liu Zhaohan, who's our former vice president, but also president of Central University when we started, who was instrumental in helping establish astronomy to the level that we are today. So CH was the astronomy in Taiwan at the time.
I first met Fred and Helen in the late 1980s in Havana, where we both were teaching at the university there. But I did not get to know him well until after he came to Academia Sinica to meet the then newly formed Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics in 1997. And almost immediately after he came back, we formed a fairly close bond. Partly because, of course, our common Havana background. But more importantly, was because our shared ideals for astronomy and space research in Taiwan. And I remember oftentimes we got together and compared notes and sought advices from each other during our meetings in Taipei. I found that one of the things I really impressed was the fact that Fred is just amazing, can do optimism. At the time, in a way, Taiwan was beginning and trying to enter the arena of big science. And Fred took the opportunity of the timing and proposed a plan for developing the Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics in the academy with profound and far-sighted scientific visions, as well as an unconventionally bold scope for the Institute. With the help of the advisory board, he was able to convince the academy as well as the funding agency to support the Institute to build the most ambitious radio astronomy program. He started by organizing the technical engineering team and sought support from local universities, also successfully tried to seek support and opportunities from leading institutes around the world. And more importantly, also, he was able to establish a very working relationship with one of the most important institutes in Taiwan, the Dongshan Institute of Science. Most important and most advanced integration house in Taiwan. And he moved relentlessly towards his original goal. And as they say, the rest is history. Now, the Institute of Astronomy and Astrophysics stands as one of the leading radio astronomy institutes in the world. So another point I want to make, which is more personal, I particularly admire Fred for his attitude and action after he discovered he had lung cancer in 1998. So a year later, my wife Jan had the same disease and that operation. I immediately consulted Frank for advices. And we got together and he explained in detail his thought and his way during the recovery stage of his disease. And I remember he told us about his qigong exercises. That really led my wife Jane later started her own qigong exercise routine. And that helped her a lot, both physically and mentally, during her fight against the disease. I'll always remember this. When Fred went back to the States to lead the NIAO in Virginia, we did not have opportunities for each other to see each other as frequently as before. But whenever he came back to Taiwan, we always tried to get together at least once during his stay. Fred had been a good friend, a wonderful colleague, and we all were missing.
When Fred came back, practically the first person he went to see after CH was Hung Ah Kwan. Because MK was instrumental in the instrumentation development efforts. So MK, please.
dear friend, distinguished guest, and colleague. It's a great kind of honor to speak here for the memory of Brad. Well, I find this really interesting, very nice photograph, which shows that's the way Brad is, always smiling with a bright background, you know, vision for the future. And then there's the other photograph given by Min Jae, from India, the deputy director now at IAA, and see how much he really concerned about the advancement of science in Taiwan. Okay, so Brad Lau is really a great scientist and an administrator, a man with a vision. I first met Brad was back in 93 or so. Taiwan probably still remember, but I remember very vividly. I think Taiwan was driving Brad to Tsinghua in the front of this old building. And we stand there for a couple minutes and then went back. And he tried to persuade me, convince me that Taiwan needed a superconducting device lab. Well, I have been a person working on superconductivity for my lifetime, but never really cared much about the real device because I'm more interested in new material, new fundamental physics, and so on. So Tai Hong and Fred came and offered Zhang Xi with us at the same time. And fortunately, that time, Min Jae Wang is just about to finish his PhD. So when I said, you know, we really need this because the astronomy development and so on, and that will lead to a very important development for the future. In the meantime, we can establish some kind of fundamental technology for this very important superconducting technology to be built in Taiwan. So we decided that, okay, we probably should do it. At that time, we were very poor. I mean, the national, you see the building, the lab was very poor. However, eventually, Min Jae took up this challenge. In October 94, we start with one person, you know, Min Jae Wang, who just finished his PhD and decided to stay. It we spent some time to convince him to stay for this business. Otherwise, he would go to the industry, which is like a TSMC. I believe he would become a great man there, a great manager at TSMC, but I think stay. And I think Brad also made this. So we had, at that time, we had a very old deposition system from IBM, donated by Zhang Qi, who came back from IBM and worked with us. So that's how we started. And it takes some time, but when Brad decided to come back to lead this institute in 97, and then he really invested, you know, put some money in. So we had a first semi clean room established in Tsinghua. At that time, I was still in Tsinghua University, and Min Jae spent most of the time working there. And of course, the building is not ready at that time, so most of the lab was done in Hsinchu. And Min Jae was able to make in this semi-clean room. And then during the time Brad served as the director, I think the capital, most of the critical capital component of building. And by 2005, then we have a real clean room set up, also in Tsinghua at that time. And that gave us this capability to really make really delicate and important devices. And eventually, I think Paul, everyone, and then continue to make this happen. So by 2010, then we have this real clean room in this brand new building. And provide all the SISS mixer for SMA and other telescope and so on. And today, we really have the world-class lab on superconducting device located here. So this is probably the best. I don't know much in China, but I think probably it's certainly in Taiwan, but maybe better, you know, in place in China. And this lab, after this about 20 years, is really full-blown to a very powerful, a very significant system that can build almost all the important superconducting or high-frequency device, you know, using us back, particularly evolving to different materials, using graphene and other. Not only that, I think media has helped train many good young scientists, young engineers, and who are doing great job now in Taiwan. And also, he has been working together, not only just dividing for this new superconducting device, but also for the development of better new material. Okay. So that's how the initiation by Brad and now Taiwan has such an important system. Okay. And the next the close contact I had with Brad was really the program for ALMA, of course, that's the main, but the most important one is ALMA, because I served as the deputy minister for the National Science Council from 2000, and that was the time the negotiation with the NSF started. Okay, well, maybe started earlier, but I had to really spend some time to talk with Mike Turner, who represented NSF at the time, and Paul was also involved. So eventually we signed the agreement. But Fred was so strong-willed and so pushing. It's a twist perseverance, really convinced me that I had to do it. But at that time, you know, a lot of questions I had received, why we should spend all the money for that. I had to, convince other people that astronomy is important and this is the area we should go for. Okay. Anyway, but of course, role help many people, including like President Liu and many people. Most important is how the budget, you know, we can allocate for this kind of program and the commitment we have to do. And fortunately, that period of time, Taiwan really enjoyed a very substantial support from the government in terms of the science and technology budget. Okay. So we sort of had, when I was working for the government, we saw that average of 8 to 10% every year for our science and technology budget. So we can allocate a specific fund for astronomy, not only that, but also for like the subconventional, the synchrotron facility was also constructed based on that kind of program. So that was how it's done in 2000, and then I came, 2002, and then I came back for working in the National Science Council from 2004 and 2006, and eventually all this continuing follow. And that really lead to this exciting moment that we all went to see the Taiwan flag flying over the mountain where the ALMA located. Okay. And that picture we have together with Frank and Brett, well, that's beautiful ALMA site. Okay. So I think that without Brad, I think probably this would not happen. And Taiwan, of course, the people now, we enjoy this wonderful facility and will lead us to better understanding of the world, the universe. Okay, so with all this, I would say thank you, Brad, what you have done. Thank you.
Thank you, MK, for a long story which really covers everything that we were doing from the beginning to today.